please stand with me, please? We're here today to celebrate the life of Jackie Reese and Jesus. We want to give glory to,
yes,
because he was definitely in and living through her life. And I hear this morning that we're going to hear some of those stories, and we're here to celebrate a life. Amen. So if you would just join me in prayer. Father, we just commit this time and this gathering, Lord, before you. We ask for your presence, Lord, to be in our midst, Lord. We know that Jackie wouldn't want it any other way. She loved you, Lord. She had a passion for you. And Lord, we just pray today that all of our lives would be inspired, Lord, by the things that we hear. Lord, that we might pursue you with the same passion. So, Father, I just pray there's a lot of memories in this room. It's going to stir a lot of emotions. But, Lord, I just would pray that you are a God that comforts. You're a God that draws near. So by the power of the Holy Spirit, we ask and invite you to be here in this service today. We ask in the precious name of Jesus. Amen and amen.
You have
your beautiful name, the name of Jesus. And what a beautiful life we experienced in the life of Jackie Reese. For followers of Jesus Christ, there is hope beyond the grave, because Jesus Christ has opened the door to heaven for us by his death and resurrection. As you're seated, turn to two or three people and just tell them, Jackie was amazing. Jackie was amazing.
Amen.
You may be seated. Jacqueline Jackie Reese lived a beautifully expansive life from February 23rd, 1929 until September 10th, 2018, when she was lovingly released from the grip of earth into the wonders of heaven. She loved Jesus with a passion and people with an unusual measure of grace. Many of us, in fact, most of us in the family, have been recipients of that grace, an unusual measure. I was reflecting on Jackie's life over the last couple days, and when you think of her and remember her, she almost always, and it's in this photo right here that Roland took for the directory here at the church, she always had a twinkle in her eye. Anybody ever notice that? She always...
Yes.
Our last full conversation, she couldn't fully smile, but she looked at me, and I saw it in her eyes. They sparkled, and that was Jackie. It was almost like Mom's eyes could sparkle with no light source. Her eyes would have sparkled in the dark because something was inside of her that shone from the inside out. It wasn't a reflection. It was actually Jesus shining through her. I think it came from deep within. She was a light in dark times for a lot of people, wasn't she? Somebody you could talk to. She had a strong and abiding faith in God, and it gave her a deep and remarkable wisdom. My name is Paul. I'm her favorite son-in-law. One might argue I was her only son-in-law. It's true, but I was her favorite. You see, what was remarkable about Mom is that when you were in conversation with her, you knew you were her favorite, didn't you? And you knew she felt that way about you. What a beautiful life. She had an amazing effect on everyone around her. I want to thank you for joining us and celebrating her life. And join the family and my beautiful wife, Judy, and son, Jerry, and his wife, Connie, and son, John, and his wife, Melissa, and in our families. And you'll meet a few of them in a few moments. Mom lived life to the fullest. We have another service on Thursday in Santa Rosa. Well, she'll be interred next to her second husband, Ken. And so many of the cousins will be there, and grandsons and grandchildren. She loved good books and good conversation. She loved friends, and she loved parties. She was always there. If you were, and you know this at CCF, and at Mercy, if you were putting an evening together with friends, always invite Jackie. She would always be there, and she would always be fun. She wasn't just book smart, though. She was life smart. Jackie was born and grew up in San Francisco, California. Her parents, George and Mildred Frund, owned the Rexall drugstores of San Francisco and also owned a couple ranches, Riverview Ranch outside Eureka, California, and Sequoia Ranch in Freestone. Jackie attended Lowell High School in San Francisco. She loved friends, parties, books, and life. She stayed in touch with her best friends from high school for the rest of her life. Jerry and I were talking about it a little earlier. She actually had a gathering with her friends just a few years ago from high school. She was a student at San Francisco City College and later graduated Sonoma State College. In 1948, she met a ruggedly handsome ranch hand, one of her grandfather's ranches, Henry Hank Lund, Riverview Ranch. Her mom wasn't happy, but Jackie was enthralled. They were married in September 1948. They lived throughout California and had one spectacular daughter and then some sons. Four children in total. In 1965, Hank suddenly passed away. Now a 35-year-old single mom with four children, Jackie and her family relocated from Fresno to Santa Rosa, California. It was a new season, but Jackie, like every new season of her life, approached it with prayer, deep faith, and expansive courage. She worked for the state of California and then opened her own business, successfully operating Reese Accounting for many years in Santa Rosa. She worked her business, took care of her children, and went back and finished college. She was amazing. As her children grew and began to move away from home, Jackie was suddenly swept off her feet by the most fascinating and charming man she had ever met, Ken Reese. Ken and Jackie were married in 1974. They laughed, loved, traveled, built a joy-filled life, and famously tipped over in a canoe together and tipped over on a jet ski. Ken was fascinated by life and by Jackie. She would walk through the room and he would lean over and say, "Isn't she fabulous?" Ken was loud and often brash. Jackie balanced Ken. And it was a beautiful balance. Jackie was a lifelong learner, an insatiable reader, and was madly in love with Ken. They were married 27 wonderful and busy years, resided in Santa Rosa. In 2001, after an illness, Ken passed away. A few years later, Mom declared to her family, "I'm going to be a missionary." She was 76 years old, and she was ready for her next adventure. In 2004, she left her home she had lived in for over 40 years and bravely relocated to East Texas to become a key part of the global missions organization, Mercy Ships, and then CCF. Mercy Ships became her cause. It became her passion. She was active and energetic here in the church. She had community groups in her home, was highly involved at Mercy, went on missions trips, traveled with single friends to Europe. Roland mentioned to me, who's doing the graphics back there, that they were in the same community group together for a while. And they're about 35 years apart. And I said, "You were? What was it?" He goes, "Singles." That was Mom. She was irrepressible. She lived in a delightful home in Hideaway, filled with love, pictures of grandchildren, sounds of birds, and desks full of accounting papers. She lived life to the fullest and lived it beautifully. I was driving these roads the last few days and have been here a number of times, of course, and I thought, what a beautiful thing for her to have been in such a wonderful place the last 14 years of her life, and to have such, in her 80s, to have such a great cause, Mercy Ships and people, because it was for her, it wasn't just about the boat, it was about the people. Amen? I was looking for a scripture to kind of close this little section. I was sitting in her chair where she would sit, look out her backyard and see the hummingbirds, and I grabbed her Bible and I began to thumb through it, and I flipped to the back, and she had written some things that meant something to her in this Bible that John and Rick gave to her in Christmas of 1971. I thought I'd just read her scriptures to us because they meant so much to her. And she had written at the top on one page, "The courage to dare and the patience to wait." She wrote Psalm 18:32, "God encircles me with strength." She wrote John 10:10, "I have life more abundantly." She wrote these out. Psalm 16:11, "You will show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand there are pleasures forevermore." She wrote at the top of one page, "Your goal controls you." When she was in her mid-80s, late-80s, she was writing down things she still wanted to do. Things to do and places to go and people to meet. Philippians 4:8, "Whatever is true, whatever is worthy of reverence, is honorable and seemly, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely and lovable, whatever is kind and winsome and gracious, if there is any virtue and excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think on and weigh and take account of these things. She wrote this. To believe means to trust in, rely on, remain steadfast to the Lord. She wrote down Isaiah 26:3. You will guard him and keep him. Keep him in perfect and constant peace, whose mind is stayed on you, because he commits himself, leans on you, and hopes confidently on you. The last thing I read out of her Bible was this. She wrote this. Faith is unshakable confidence in the character of God. I'm one of the most fortunate men on earth to have fallen in love with a beautiful girl who was raised by an amazing mom. Jerry, John, and Rick, of all people on earth, what a blessing to have this legacy for your children and their children. To have been chosen by God to be one of Jackie's sons. No greater blessing could a man have than to be the son or daughter of Jacqueline Lund Reese. And we, her friends, we were the most fortunate people on earth to have known and loved and been loved by Jackie Reese. So remarkable, so beautiful, so full of joy was the life of Jackie Reese. The world will never again be the same. Her grandson, Danny, put together this video remembrance of her life.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee, thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever, forever will be. Summer, summer and winter, in the springtime and in the harvest, the sun, moon, and stars in their courses up above, they join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, to all of your mercies, and to all of your love. You give a pardon for all my sins, and you give a peace that always endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer me and to guide me along my way. You gave me strength for today and bright hope. You give me hope for all my tomorrows. Oh, thank you, Lord. Blessings all mine with 10,000, 10,000 just thrown in besides. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Every time I wake up in the morning, new mercies, your breath. And all I have ever needed, your hands, your great big hands have already provided. Oh, and I'm mighty grateful, Lord. Great is thy faithfulness. Oh, thank you, Lord. Great is thy faithfulness. I give glory to your name, Most High God. So great is thy faithfulness, Lord.
Kids and grandkids, what a beautiful, beautiful life. Amen? And one of her great friends, they worked together at Mercy Ships, is Ken Weinbar. Ken, come on up, and I want you to share a remembrance of Jackie. She loved this place, and she loved the ministry, and she appreciated so much you and your family.
Thank you, Paul. We appreciated Jackie very much. And I'm going to try to stick to the script here, because contrary to popular belief, I'm really not long-winded. I just have a lot to say, okay? And I think I'm going to need to get these glasses on, too. I was hoping not to have to do that. Today is a celebration, even though sorrow is running through our hearts due to the passing of one fine lady, Jackie Reese. Guess I was wrong, dear. Monday night, I laid awake a lot, struggling with that sorrow. As I got up and spent time with the Lord, he laid this phrase from the song Forever Rain by Hillsong on my heart. It says, death has lost its sting. As I pondered those words from the Lord, Jackie's death began to lose its sting for me. I reflected back on a beautiful lady, that one right there, who was not just my administrative assistant, but my buddy and my dear friend, a friend to me and to my family, and obviously to all of you as well. She was one of my confidants. We'd sit and have those talks, Paul, like you were talking about. She was my cheerleader, and would always encourage me to greater heights, to write, and continue investing in others, something that she did so ably as well. I started to write down my thoughts, and the Lord took me to 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 5. The Message Bible puts it this way: what a God we have, and how fortunate we are to have him. this Father of our Master Jesus. Because Jesus was raised from the dead, we've been given a brand new life and everything to live for, including a future in heaven. And a future starts now. God is keeping careful watch over us and the future. The day is coming when you will have it all, life healed and whole. Now, Jackie has it all. As I finished writing, I sensed I was to post these thoughts on a blog on our Navigator, our Mercy Ship's internal webpage, something that Jackie encouraged me to do on a regular basis. It's titled it Thoughts from My Farm. Last week I began, it became the most popular blog post on our Navigator website, not because of my writing, but because of the amazing lady it was written about. I ask our staff to rejoice with me, knowing that Jackie now has it all, and that death has lost its sting. I received replies back from representatives from 10 different departments because Jackie was loved all over the campus. I also received a phone call from Oregon and a few messages back from some of our missionaries that Jackie so ably supported here at CCF. I would like to share a couple of those comments because I think it shares who Jackie was. One shared, may we all be remembered as well for our faithful service to God. Another said, I was so sad last night when I heard this news about Jackie, but know that she can breathe wonderfully today. No more pain, no more sorrow for her. Thanks for the reminder that Jesus took the sting out of death. One quoted Ecclesiastes 7:1, the day you die is better than the day you're born. And also quoted Max Lucado's words, now there is a twist. Heaven enjoys a maternity ward reaction to funerals. Angels watch body burials the same way grandparents monitor delivery room doors. He'll be coming through any minute. They can't wait to see the new arrival. While we're driving hearses and wearing black, they're hanging pink and blue streamers. I thought, you know, what the heck? Pink and blue streamers beat the heck out of black and hearses, doesn't it? The final reply was this, what a sweet, kind, and fine lady Jackie was, very committed and faithful to her Lord and the task that he has given her. She will truly be missed, but I know she is so excited to be with her Lord. Heaven is rejoicing. Yesterday morning, it was the words of another song, In Christ Alone, that the Lord spoke to my heart once again about Jackie. These words summarize Jackie's life in my mind. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ, I'll stand. Jackie Reese stood with Christ right here, and now she stands with him today in heaven. I know that Jackie would want the same for each of us sitting here. I, too, want to encourage you that if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior and your friend, your future can start right now. Jackie would say, you need to do that. And she wouldn't make any bones about it, would she? Thank you for the opportunity to share. I'll miss her. Big time.
Amen. Thank you, Kent. And her community group leaders were Scott and Sandy Tompkins. If you'll come up right now, Scott and Sandy, and bring a remembrance of Jackie. We all have things, and by the way, in the reception, we're going to do an open mic. If you want to share some things, we'll be able to do that there, Scott.
Well, thank you for the privilege of sharing. And it was such a privilege to have Jackie in our life group here at CCF. We didn't know her at all about 4 years ago when she came into the group. And within a month, we loved this woman. She was just amazing. And she surprised me initially in a couple of very significant ways. The first was her age. I mean, when I came to find out how old she was, I was shocked because she didn't live like a person who was in her late 80s. And she, as you said, Paul, she had that twinkle in her eye. She had a zest for life. She was a kingdom person. And that was the other thing that just struck me so much about Jackie. She wanted her life to count for God. And so she was so continually pouring herself out for the Lord in different ways. And we came to see that over the years in the life group. You know, she would take people into her home, sometimes for months at a time. She was so generous and kind in that way. She would, you know, of course, she was in the group. I always loved when we'd do meals because she'd bring stuff from the Collins Street Bakery. And that was a treat for me. Anyway, she was just so generous, helping people with their taxes. I just on and on. She was just always living her life to the full. And when I understood her story and the things that she had gone through, you know, a lot of people who had lost two husbands and had gone through the difficulties of life that Jackie went through, some of them turn away from God, but not Jackie. She just had this strength of character and this deep passion for the Lord that caused her to rise to new heights. And she was just so inspiring in that way, just amazing the way she lived her life. And we were truly blessed. And I want to just say one other thing. You know, in life group, we would always take time to take prayer requests, and often she would have us pray for her family. She loved her kids and her grandkids so much, and she was very proud of you all. And but anything that was going on that she felt she needed a little extra prayer for, you know, she'd invite us to join. And so that's one of my remembrances of Jackie. She was just a woman of great character and love, and we will miss her.
There's not a lot I can add to that was heartfelt. We did love Jackie, one of the kindest women I've ever met. And I'm jealous for all those years you had this remarkable woman, because we didn't know that Jackie. And I mean, I stand amazed at what she did and what she accomplished. And 76, she volunteered to be a missionary. I just turned 70 and I feel like my life's over, you know. And here she is, ready to go. I just marvel. We had the privilege of having her in our group for 4 years, and she was an inspiration to all of us and a prayer warrior. And we went many times. That's how we met Jackie, is at the hospital, at the rehab, as she was having medical issues. What did I say?
I meant
Judy. Sorry. But you are the great daughter, you know, yeah. Paul said. The extraordinary daughter. And I loved seeing those pictures of you with her, you know, because when we were visiting and praying, we were praying for healing. And I was struck today during this time, Paul, when you were sharing, that she is healed. God did heal her in a wonderful way. And we rejoice that, and I'm wearing bright colors because this is a celebration. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And you mentioned to me on the phone, Scott, that she was a recruiter. She brought a bunch of her friends to your group, right? She always pulled people in. I was driving her back from where we live in Grapevine to her home here. may have been 4 or 5 years ago. It wasn't any time where we were thinking about this, but she turned to me and she said, "Do you know that video, He's My King, the pastor that did that? That's my king." And I said, "Yeah, Mom, I know that video." She goes, "I want that at my memorial service." I said, "All right, Mom, so here it is."
The Bible says my king is the king of the Jews. He's the king of Israel. He's the king of righteousness. He's the king of the ages. He's the king of heaven. He's the king of glory. He's the king of kings. And he's the Lord of lords. That's my king. I wonder, do you know him? My king is a sovereign king. No means of measure can define his limitless love. He's enduringly strong. He's entirely sincere. He's eternally steadfast. He's immortally graceful. He's imperially powerful. He's impartially merciful. Do you know him? He's the greatest phenomenon that has ever crossed the horizon of this world. He's God's son. He's a sinner's savior. He's the centerpiece of civilization. He's unparalleled. He's unprecedented. He is the loftiest idea in literature. He's the highest personality in philosophy. He's the fundamental doctrine of true theology. He's the only one qualified to be an all sufficient savior. I wonder if you know him today. He supplies strength for the weak. He's available for the tempted and the tried. He sympathizes and he saves. He strengthens and sustains. He guards and he guides. He heals the sick. He cleanses the lepers. He forgives sinners. He discharges debtors. He delivers the captive. He defends the feeble. He blesses the young. He serves the unfortunate. He regards the aged. He rewards the diligent. And he purifies the meek. I wonder if you know him. He's the key to knowledge. He's the wellspring of wisdom. He's the doorway of deliverance. He's the pathway of peace. He's the roadway of righteousness. He's the highway of holiness. He's the gateway of glory. Do you know him? Well, his life is matchless. His goodness is limitless. His mercy is everlasting. His love never changes. His word is enough. His grace is sufficient. His reign is righteous. And his yoke is easy. And his burden is lighter. I could describe him, but yet he's indescribable. He's incomprehensible. He's invincible. He's irresistible. Well, you can't get him out of your mind. You see, you can't get him off of your head. You can't outlive him, and you can't live without him. Well, the Pharisees couldn't stand him, but they found out they couldn't stop him. Pilate couldn't find any fault in him. Herod couldn't kill him.
Oh man, that was Mom. She said, "I want that played." She would love that. I want my three children to come up, Lindsay and Bryce and Brandon. And she has a number of grandchildren. Many will be sharing this coming Thursday out in Santa Rosa. And she was proud of her grandkids. I walked in to her home some time ago, and I looked around and I thought, it's all grandchildren shots. There are children. But the grandchildren, that was something special for her. And I wanted to introduce my daughter, Lindsay Holsinger.
Oh, you did? You guys rewrite. We switched up the order. It's a family thing. Yeah, we get that privilege today, I guess. My name is Bryce, and I'm the youngest. Of my siblings, and I wrote out what I wanted to say, because I can't, I'm not even going to make it through this, so good Lord, trying to do it without notes. But there's not much more I could say today that could add to what you already think of my grandmother. It's probably a given that you already think very highly of her, and you would be correct in doing so. She truly was a lovely person in every way. All I can offer you is my reflections on who is and always will be one of the kindest human beings I've ever known. And when I was growing up and all of my grandparents were living, we didn't have special nicknames for them like some of you may have, like Papa or Mima or even Gammy. We had my father's parents, which we just called Grandma and Grandpa. And then we had my mother's, Grandpa Ken and Grandma Jackie. It's so ingrained in my head that it's Grandma Jackie that that even when she was the sole surviving grandparent of four for me, she was still Grandma Jackie, even in our conversations, as if we had to clarify. But I always love the memories I have of going to their ranch in California as a child and into my teens before the death of Grandpa Ken. The two identical dachshunds running around with a blue and red collar and family everywhere, climbing the tree out back where there was a tiny piece of wood stuck in between two branches, which I'm not sure who put that there. But it was the closest thing I would ever know to a treehouse, and I would run up there. It was the first thing I did every time we got there. I would run up, I'd climb up these trees with this little step and sit on this or stand on this piece of wood that was my treehouse. I just loved being there. It was usually for Christmas or some type of fun family gathering, and it was loud and crazy and fun and just how you would love for it to be as a kid jacked up on eggnog. And Uncle Jerry and John and the brothers cracking jokes and making everyone laugh. And my cousins dividing themselves up into the cooler, older kids. And then me, my brother, and Caleb. And Grandpa Ken making himself heard for anyone who would hear. I'll never forget his booming voice. And in a chair somewhere, not in the shadows, but certainly behind all of the noise, was my smiling grandmother. I don't know how, but her smile seemed permanent to me. Maybe because from this day to those days, I don't remember it not being a part of her usual expression. It was a fixed position, because when family was around, she was truly in her happy place. And as the years have gone on and time grew heavy on her, that smile never faded. And her almost persistence on never being the center of attention, but always content to just be there and be happy, never changed. We would have birthday parties and usually family gatherings and at my mom and dad's after she had moved to Texas. And she would come, sit down, watch everyone hang out and laugh and be part of it while never making herself the center of anything. Then the noise would dissipate a little. People would start to settle down and her voice would hit my ear and ask me how life was. Just so kind and so patient. And that's who my Grandma Jackie was to me. I so wish I had sat with her more at the edge of all the noise to hear more of what she had to say. It was always warm and encouraging. She cared deeply without letting on too much. And that I could always tell. I really did admire her. And that's something I wish I could have told her before she passed, because I don't know that I ever did. But Grandma Jackie, you were a treasure, a gift to the earth for so many. Your laugh is stitched into my memory of you, holding together the tapestry of who you are. We are all so lucky to have had you. And to my mom, you are a reflection of who she is. And your strength over the past few years gave us all more life with her. This day, I want to honor you as well, because it's not easy taking care of a loved one who is passing away, especially not your mother. And not many people know what it's like to sacrifice as much as you did over the past few years to be with her while it became so hard. You have battled on behalf of her like a warrior. And I'm so incredibly proud to be your son. Thank you for fighting her like no one else could. And I know in my heart, as true as I can see your face right now, that she is so proud to have called you her daughter. And not just her daughter, her greatest friend. Love you.
And this is my daughter, Lindsay Holsinger.
That was a mistake, letting you go first. I didn't write anything down. So I want to echo what Bryce said about getting more life with her, because you were so intentional about bringing her in all the time. And, you know, when we were growing up, we were in Texas. She was in California, so we saw her maybe once a year. But we were so fortunate the last 15 years or so to be able to actually have so much time with her. Four or five, maybe even more than that sometimes a year. We got to go to Magnolia and spend time together. And one of my favorite memories was a couple years ago, my husband was doing a retreat at Sky Ranch. And so we were right around the corner. And so at night, I would bring our two-year-old and we'd go spend the night at Grandma Jackie's house. And we just got to sit and talk uninterrupted. We just had just the two of us sitting in her living room. And it was just so fun. It was just like, she wasn't just my grandma. We were like having really easy conversation and just enjoying talking to each other. And she was just such a great listener. I'm sure you all know that. And she was so patient and so non-judgmental. She was not critical ever. We have four children and two nephews, and it's a force when we all get together. And sometimes I would go, oh my gosh, everything's crazy. And I would look and see if grandma was making this face or that face. And she was usually making the nice one. And so I thought, okay, we're good. But she was just such a calming person, just so sweet. And I'm sure she got frustrated, but I never saw that. Never. When we went to Magnolia, there was a line all the way, you know, when it was first open, and there was just lines everywhere. And so I stayed in line, and mom took grandma, and they took her little seat. They just sat her right up in front, and she just sat there and just watched everybody and just waited for us to catch up with her. And we just had so much fun. She was just so pleasant. And talking about this with my kids has reminded me, you know, that it's not so final. It feels final, and it feels sad. But like my daughter Dylan says, we're going to see her again when the horn blows. I'm like, you're right. That's true. And my oldest is named after her. Her name is Jacqueline Reese, and she goes by Reese, but sometimes she'd rather be called Jacqueline, and I don't blame her for that. But anyways, I just miss her. And I don't really, I should have written stuff down. Anyway, yeah.
This is my son, Pastor Brandon Cole.
Man, that was awesome. I don't know why I'm last on this one. I'm the son who has the two boys who were given a whole row to hang out on, which has worked out really well for us. But I just wrote a few things down, and when Bryce told me he wrote a few things down, I didn't realize what he meant. I actually just wrote a few things down. But I do remember, as I was talking today, as we were talking with all the people as they came in, how many more things I could have written. And I've been told by my wife I have an ugly cry, so I'm trying not to But I remember going to the ranch and the fish tank that at some point became less of a fish tank and more of just a collection of things. And I remember the horse. I remember the axe that we kept trying to cut wood with, never successfully. I remember the pseudo treehouse. I also remember the dachshunds. And I remember staying the night at that house. And I remember the house always feeling like home. You just every time you walked in, you didn't ever think you didn't belong there. The VCR we broke, and all the things we didn't do there properly. I remember all of it. And obviously, as I grew older, I appreciated certain things more. I remember talking to Grandma Jackie about every book we were reading, and how animated she would get, as though everything else was cool, until you started talking about the book you were reading, and then she stood up or sat up and would begin to point at things that weren't there because she was so animated about everything that was going on. I remember the times that she would argue with my mom or passionately discuss things with my mom, and it made me feel better about me doing that. I remember the Christmas gifts that she would give that, even if they didn't, even if they didn't quite hit the mark, I just remember always feeling really proud of them. I always remember feeling like she did everything she could to make sure that we felt like we were receiving something valuable and something important. And that's the way she made you feel. And the thing that has maybe struck me the most over the last several days, and even a few people were here today, are the text messages and the calls at church. People who maybe interacted with my grandmother a few times, a handful of times, who were so struck by and so encouraged by and so loved by. It blew me away to see how much she impacted people, even with this small amount of time. I will always remember Grandma Jackie's smile. And I need to close it out because my two-year-old is in the aisle. No, that's not even a joke. But I love Grandma Jackie, and I think Bryce and Lindsay said it best. And I'm so thankful for, and I can't miss this part, the last 10 years. She was a hero of mine, because to see her, one, leave California, which is a strange decision, but to come to Texas and decide to do missions work. And when she got here, it didn't turn out the way she had expected. And she didn't turn around and go back. She didn't decide that that was her out. She stayed for a decade and made family and made community. And she will always be a hero of mine for that. And I love my uncles and my mom, and I'm so thankful for my grandmother, Jackie.
It would give them a hand. Pastor Dave, if you'd come up. Mom's pastor, Pastor Dave, began to finish the day, but she loved this church. She loved you. She loved being a part of this. And I just thank God for, again, where she was for the last 12, 14 years. Pastor Dave Hickey.
Guys, it's been fun to listen to the interaction. I love the sibling rivalry and all of that, and seeing the kids playing here reaffirms why you should never play with the preacher's kids, because they could grow up to become like them. No. I get it. Today we are celebrating, are we not? And all I can do is kind of echo, which one of you mentioned about the blowing of the horn? I'd like to see that. That is great theology. Yeah, that's great theology. Essentially, that's my message. So when we hear the horn toot, we're out of here. We're going to Daddy's house. And that's what it is. I just want to remind us of that. It won't take long. Let not your hearts be troubled. Okay? We can be saddened by the brief separation, but I've been on the planet a while now, and believe me, it's brief. I don't care if you got another 20, 30 years, it's going to go like that. Boom, boom, boom. Oh, times are moving. So it's just a brief separation. But let not your hearts be troubled. Jesus said, you believe in God? Believe me. Believe me. In my Father's house. I love that. In my Father's house. If anybody on the planet had authority to speak about the Father's house, Jesus did. He lived there. That was home. He came down here and did his 33 years, but in my Father's house. And I want to remind us all here, it's real, guys. It's real. If Jesus was born of a virgin, if Jesus lived a sinless life, if he died on a cross for my sins and rose the third day, then there's a heaven. You can't cherry pick. If all that's real, heaven's real. If heaven's not real, nothing's real. It's all a package. In my Father's house are many mansions, dwelling places, rooms, whatever you want to call it. In my Daddy's house, there's a place for me. And I was just thinking about it. I know as days and months and years pass, you're going to struggle a little bit, because I know we all get to the edge. I don't want to fall off this thing, so let me pretend to be on the edge but not fall off. We get to the edge. Sometimes it's a little bit hard to stretch that faith out and say, okay, heaven, 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 because we haven't seen it, but it's there. And I just want us to stretch our faith just a little bit more and realize it's just as real as anything. In fact, it's more real. I think earth is more of an illusion and heaven is the real deal. When we get there, life is real. And I've thought about this. You know, I'm looking at her smile. And I'm thinking to myself, one of the thoughts I had was, one of the reasons why we need new bodies, I don't think there's enough facial muscles to put on the new smile that we need to have when we finally see Jesus face to face and realize this deal is real. My gosh, can you imagine how she's smiling now when she sees her Savior? So I want you to push back. I ran to the car there. You wonder where I went for a minute, but I had to get this quote. I feel like the Lord wanted me to share this. When the enemy wants to come and cause you doubt, this is one of the things you can say back to your enemy. He says, this is from Perry Stone. He says, I have said for years that when the enemy comes to torment you from anything from the past, remind him of his future. He is an unemployed cherub that was removed from his position as a worship leader in heaven. He hangs out with other losers called fallen angels. Remind him that his obituary has already been written and his final destination is the lake of fire. So that's how to kind of push him back. I've got a destination called heaven. He's got a destination called the lake of fire. And so today, let's stir up faith in our hearts. Heaven is real, and now it's even more real because you've got another loved one there that's enjoying it. Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house, many mansions. If it weren't so, I wouldn't tell you. I tell you because it's so. Find comfort there. Encourage each other today. Guys, it's real.
Daughter, Judy. I am her favorite daughter. I just wanted to take a moment today. Hold on, my stuff. I didn't know your stuff was going to be here too, so I'm trying to make room for all my stuff. I just wanted to say thank you today for to all of you for loving my mom and for being here today. You know, she loved her life here. She loved working at Mercy Ships. She loved her church. She loved serving on the missions committee. She loved counting the offering. She loved her connect groups. She was happy. One of the things she really loved was her little house. And one of the things that became really important to me over the last few months, and was that I wanted to get her home, and I wanted to, her to be in her sweet little house, surrounded by the things that she loved, by the people that she loved, and that she would get well, that she would be better. And she loved having her friends over. She loved hosting in her home and having connect groups and gatherings there. She loved working with you, Ken. She felt a deep friendship beyond work. The Mercy Ship community was something she cherished. Thank you. She loved her church community. She was such a huge, it was such a huge part of her life. And we definitely felt your prayers over the last few months. And many of you came to visit at the hospital and at rehab, and I was always so impressed by that, so impressed that you didn't forget her during those times. In December of last year, the doctor told her she should stay away from large gatherings, and so the one time we did come back to church, it had been probably 6 months since she'd been to church, but no, you guys did not forget her. You came by to visit her, and that meant a lot to her, that she wasn't forgotten. To Pastor Roy and Pastor David, every time I came to visit, every time I was here, you guys came by to visit. We ran into you everywhere. Thank you. Thank you for doing that. Thank you for being so diligent. And you're lucky to have them as pastors for their care. To the girl gang, I'm going to forget some of you, but and some of you I don't know. But to Kat, to Karen, to Bonnie, to Molly, thank you so much for sitting with her, for bringing her dinner, for loving her, for just being a friend to her. She loved you guys so very much. So thank you for your friendship and your love. And I don't know if Kurt is here, but thank you, Kurt, for fixing absolutely everything. To Dr. Lowry and to Dr. King, our deepest and heartfelt gratitude for doing absolutely everything in your power to keep her alive. I know that you did your very best, and we are very grateful, as a family, very grateful. And finally, there are two people that I have grown to love very deeply, and that I just have to especially thank. Carolyn Ramsey, you were so devoted, you were so kind and loving, and I know that Mom meant the world to you. That last day when, the last couple of days, when we were trying to get her to eat, she didn't really want to eat very much. And I can just see her, Carolyn was, "Now, Jackie, come on now. You have to eat. You have to eat so you can get well." And she'd always say, "You gotta drink those Pedialytes. You got to drink your Pedialytes." And baking soda cleaned everything. So thank you, sweet one, from the bottom of my heart, for taking such good care of her. And Jan Hancock, I know you're not going to like this, but I don't have enough words to thank you, and I don't know where you are. I can't see you right now. Not enough words. You loved her, and you cared for her as if she were your own mom. You came to live with her as a friend when we needed somebody to just be there and to just be a companion, really. And then it became a lot more. And I completely panicked when you left this summer, because I thought, how are we going to do this? I mean, I can cover daytime, but I don't have anybody to do the nighttime. How am I going to do this? But you know, in that season of time, that was a great gift to me, because I had the sweetest, intimate time with my mom over the last few months that you could not take away from me for anything now. You didn't sign up for the journey. You didn't sign up for, none of us knew what was ahead. None of us knew how difficult it would be. But from my family and from me, I just want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for being such a loving, caring, wonderful caregiver and friend, and for loving her through everything. I'm so deeply in debt to you. Thank you so very much. You know, God knew this season. He knew what was coming. He knew how this would all end. And her loss is incredibly devastating. Incredibly devastating. And we grieve deeply for this beautiful, amazing woman that we had the honor to call mother, grandmother, great-grandmother, and friend. You lived well, Jackie Reese. You were magnificent.
Just stand with us now. We're going to sing one final song.
Let go my soul and trust in me.
Amen. Come on, somebody. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you for this amazing and beautiful and wonderful promise that because Jesus is alive, Jackie is alive, well and healed and rejoicing. So, Father, it is to us, we pray right now, that we would commit our lives to walk in the same grace, to walk in that same manner that Jackie walked, that we would love those who you put in front of us, that, Father, we would touch with the touch of love, that we would sense those others who might be hurting, and we would turn from our path in order to reach out to them, for that truly is who you are, Father. And that's what we experienced, new and loved, in Jackie. Father, for those of us as family, thank you for blessing us with this beautiful, precious life. Strong, diligent, resilient, stalwart. She was a woman of God. And I thank you, Father, for a legacy that we will live not only in your children and grandchildren, but their children in years to come. Thank you, Father, for this time together. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Romans 15:13 says this. Now may the God of hope, everybody say hope, fill you with all joy and peace in believing that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. I'd like to invite the family to go ahead and exit. We've got a reception planned for you if you'll let the family get there first, and then you can greet them. Would you turn to two or three people around you and just thank the Lord for who that person is that you're touching right now, the same way Jackie would have. Thank you so much. Thank you, Pastor David. Thank you, Pastor Roy. Thank you, Roland, Kevin. Thank you guys for ministry. God bless you all.